Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Like Wolves on the Fold, The Defense of Rorke's Drift, by Lieutenant Colonel Mike Snook, foreword by Lieutenant Colonel Hugh Lloyd-Jones, narrated by Mike Cooper. Foreword. The Defense of Rorke's Drift is one of the most famous and enduring tales of British arms. Yet the fate of the nation did not hang on the outcome of the battle, as in 1940, nor did victory herald the final defeat of a sworn enemy, as was the case in 1815. The battle saw no great technological leap forward, nor did it entail any brilliant military innovations. Instead, our fascination with the Rorke's Drift episode has much more in common with the esteem in which we hold Henry V's band of brothers. A plucky few, far from home, outnumbered and with their backs to the wall, who pull off a seemingly impossible victory. For this, too, is a boy's own story. Just as Shakespeare's pen guaranteed Agincourt's place as an iconic moment in the history of these islands, so did Sir Stanley Baker's cinematic epic Zulu serve to immortalise the story of Rorke's Drift. It can be both a boon and a curse to the historian when the arts and the past collide. On the one hand, great artistic portrayals can engender immense public interest in a subject, but on the other hand, they tend to entrench distortion and myth. In this, the second of his Anglo-Zulu War books, my old friend and one-time company commander strips away the numerous misconceptions that surround Rorke's Drift. In doing so, he succeeds in demonstrating why the true story is fit to be considered as one of the great tales of human fortitude and tenacity. Rightly, he draws no distinction between Britain and Zulu. I was commissioned into the Royal Regiment of Wales, the modern-day descendant of the old 24th, in the 1980s. Now, 20 years on, it has fallen to me to be the last commanding officer of the last RRW battalion. I have served alongside the author throughout that time. As a subaltern, I served under his command in the Far East. It falls to company commanders to bring up their young officers in the ways of the regiment and to instill in them pride in the heroic deeds of their forebears. I could not have wished for a better education. Inevitably, the most gripping of Mike's stories were those of Isandlwana and Rorke's Drift. Even then, he seemed to know every detail of these hard-fought actions. Sitting in the officers' mess in Stanley Fort, Hong Kong, surrounded by the regiment's memorabilia, he could bring our paintings and artifacts to life like no other. In the years that followed, he enthralled successive generations of our officers and soldiers, inspiring great regimental pride in them. At one point in his career, he was posted to live and work in South Africa. As a consequence, he brings to the party a highly developed understanding of the land and its people. Not least, he is a great admirer of the Zulu. He combines the historian's grasp of primary source material, a professional soldier's eye for ground, and a raconteur's turn of phrase. Here, in these chapters, he unfolds the splendid tales he once told for me for the benefit of a much wider audience. Through a series of name changes from the 24th Regiment of Foot to the South Wales Borderers to the Royal Regiment of Wales, the events of 1879 have remained preeminent in the regiment's folklore. Down the years, in all great moments of peril, from Flanders to Normandy, from Malaya to Aden, and from Belfast to Basra, the fight at Rorke's Drift has been an inspiration to our officers and soldiers. Inevitably, the current round of reforms to the regimental system will once again require us to adjust our identity. On the 1st of March 2006, the Royal Regiment of Wales will merge with the Royal Welsh Fusiliers to become a two-battalion regiment known as the Royal Welsh. Needless to say, the events of January 1879 will continue to be preserved prominently under the new arrangements. We're fortunate to have Mike's books as a historical handrail at such an important time. Our proudest traditions will march inexorably on. The Queen's collar will continue to be adorned with a silver wreath of immortelles. The battle honour South Africa, 1877-8-9, will still be borne on the regimental colour. Neville Coghill's sword will continue to hang in pride of place between the colours and, when on parade, be worn by the Queen's colour ensign. We will commemorate Rorke's Drift Day each year and will march past to that most rousing of battle songs, Men of Harlech. The second company of the 2nd Battalion will be known as B, Rorke's Drift Company. In his first book, How Can Man Die Better?, Mike analysed the disastrous sequence of events that culminated in the crushing Zulu victory at Isandlwana. That book has established him in the public eye as one of the foremost experts in the field. In my view, no other author has been able to master the details of the fight whilst at the same time recounting the episode with such clarity. He now brings these same skills to bear on those remarkable few hours at Rorke's Drift. Like Wolves on the Fold provides the most comprehensive assessment of the battle I have yet read, and then goes on to address, and I would say resolve, the controversies that still surround Isandlwana. It is, without doubt, a work of the very highest quality. Colonel Hugh Lloyd Jones, Commanding Officer, 1st Battalion, the Royal Regiment of Wales, 24th, 41st Foot. Preface. The Assyrian came down like a wolf on the fold, and his cohorts were gleaming in purple and gold, and the sheen of their spears was like stars on the sea, when the blue wave rolls nightly on deep Galilee. Like the leaves of the forest when summer is green, that host with their banners at sunset were seen. Like the leaves of the forest when autumn hath blown, that host on the morrow lay withered and strown. The Destruction of Sennacherib, Lord Byron. By breakfast time, the great chain of events was already in motion. Wednesday, the 22nd of January, 1879, was set to become one of the most calamitous days in the long history of the British Empire, one of the most renowned in the august history of Britain's standing army, and one of the most momentous in the timeless history of Southern Africa. Like Wolves on the Fold picks up the story of that most remarkable of days from my first book, How Can Man Die Better? We left Lieutenant Colonel Lord Chelmsford, Colonel Richard Glynn, and the remnants of No. 3 Column bivouacked in a state of shocked and stunned disbelief amongst the grisly remains of their slaughtered comrades, men they had soldiered with, men they had admired, men they had great affection for, all of them reduced now to mere butchered carcasses, silent, still, and strewn grotesquely through all that was left of their sacked encampment. In parts 1 and 2 of this second volume, we examine the equally dramatic events which took place on the other bank of the Buffalo River, the famous episode centred upon the mission station at Rorke's Drift. The first two parts of this second book stand alone and can be enjoyed without reference to How Can Man Die Better. But additionally, in part 3, we examine the subsequent course of the war, revisit Isandlwana to discuss the issue of culpability and blame, and reflect on the fates and destinies of many of the war's most notable participants, some of whom are central only to the first volume. To derive maximum enjoyment from part 3 of this book, it will have been beneficial to have read How Can Man Die Better?, not as part of some cunning marketing ploy, but simply because of the way so rich and complex a story plays itself out across two more readily affordable volumes. In these two books, I've been moved to dissect the battles of Isandlwana and Rorke's Drift specifically from a soldier's perspective, in the hope that the insights of a military professional might contribute usefully to our modern-day understanding of the events of 1879. I've done so partly out of concern that some recent contributions in the field seem to have led down a number of false trails. I hope, then, to straighten the tiller. Rorke's Drift, we all know, was the ultimate triumph against the odds, an impossible victory. How could a mere 150 men, of whom almost a quarter were hospital patients, standing behind an improvised barricade of mealie bags, hold off some 4,500 assailants? We struggled to comprehend how this could happen. Often, we mistakenly, but perhaps understandably, attribute it to being a victory of men armed with rifles over men armed with spears. We put it down, inevitably, to British pluck, the same determination in adversity that got 338,000 men off the beaches at Dunkirk, when by rights this should not have been so. Perhaps, we reason, there is some magical quality in the British national temperament that leaps to the fore when things are going badly awry. The worse the situation, it seems, the brighter this quality shines forth. Never was there a better example than the defence of Rorke's Drift. But perhaps we British are just a little self-satisfied about this idiosyncratic national trait. The truth is that, just as there were sound military reasons why the Wehrmacht and Luftwaffe were unable to overwhelm the BEF in 1940, so too were there military factors which account for the inability of the Zulu to overrun a determined band of redcoats on the Buffalo River. That is not to say that British pluck did not play an extensive role. It did. It may well be true that only the British infantry, that most steadfast caste of fighting men, could have done it. If forced to put one's finger on the exact nature of this mysterious British trait, it is perhaps best characterised as a stubborn refusal to panic. It was precisely this attribute which allowed the 1st Battalion of the 24th Regiment to make so brave a stand at Isandlwana. I hope that How Can Man Die Better conveyed this effectively. Panic is a killer, a destroyer of armies. It was the panic that seized Durnford's native horse that precluded any possibility of a strong enough stand being made in the saddle to hold back the Zulu left horn and so allow the 24th to fall back to a new line of defence. So panic had reared its virulently contagious head already that day. Unsurprisingly, the terrified native infantry and the non-combatants had also been infected by it. Then the fugitives in their turn. Even at Rorke's Drift, the contagion did not immediately come to a halt. Kipling famously characterised one of the essential qualities of manliness as the ability to keep one's head when all around are losing theirs. That is precisely what John Chard, Gonville Bromhead and the other 150 men who stood their ground at Rorke's Drift did. They kept their nerve, stopped the rot, and did what their training told them was militarily prudent. Famously, neither of these officers was a cutting-edge thruster, but neither were they, as some modern historians would suggest, mere low-calibre plodders. Much of this cynicism is based on the backbiting correspondence of officers like Major Francis Cleary, men who had themselves played a part in botching the Isandlwana campaign and who were hugely jealous of the two subalterns' great achievement. Furthermore, they were writing of the victors of Rorke's Drift, whom they had barely known beforehand, at a time when the two officers were recovering from an extremely traumatic experience. In 1879, there was nothing that would pass for the trauma counselling of today. It's hardly surprising that both men were withdrawn and little inclined to be patronised by those who were not there. Bromhead tended to move away whenever the subject came up. To his colleagues and the wider empire, it was a glorious deed, but for Bromhead himself, it had been a vicious, harrowing dogfight. In many ways, there is an element of the miraculous about his survival, for he was fearlessly brave and terribly exposed throughout the fight. It must have seemed, for a long while, minute by agonising minute, that it was only a matter of time before he was killed or maimed. The uncharitable comments on Chard and Bromhead were penned at a time when they were in a psychological state for which today they would receive formal medical treatment, but which, in the Victorian era, went unheeded, unrecognised and untreated. In fact, both Chard and Bromhead were typical of their kind. They were experienced professionals and knew their business well. Both were modest, mild-mannered men by temperament. Most men at Rorke's Drift were, and yet they fought like lions. Perhaps one of the most significant messages of this famous battle is that the most ordinary of men can move mountains when they are put to it. Maybe that is what we like best about the tale. The cataclysmic events at Isandlwana were surely drama enough for one day, but extraordinarily, as if to herald the portentous news to the rest of southern Africa, its final stages were played out under a partial eclipse of the sun. When the last British soldier died beneath the Sphinx, Wednesday the 22nd of January had all but run its course. Sunset was only 4 hours away. The day may have been on its last legs, but the drama was far from over. In this second book, I hope to explain how it was that the apparently miraculous victory at Rorke's Drift was actually achieved. In doing so, we will hear that there was no miracle, but rather some soldiering of the very highest order. It was not confined to one man or a few men. Every man present played his part. With only a few exceptions, Chard, Bromhead, Dalton, and the half-dozen soldiers fighting in defence of the hospital patients, the defenders of Rorke's Drift were not required to think or make decisions. This was war at its simplest, nose to nose, face to face, hand to hand. Each man had charge of his own little stretch of barricade and had nowhere else to go. His duty was to defend his sector at the cost of his life, if necessary, and, where possible, help out the mates left and right of him with a well-timed snapshot or a lightning-quick thrust of the bayonet. It was the simplest of military propositions, and to fail in it meant certain death. Perhaps it is easier to fight for one's life at close quarters when there is no other option than to skirmish forward into an extremely heavy fire when alternatives abound. And yet, this is precisely what the Zulu participants in the battle did. They took extremely heavy punishment for an hour, for 2 hours, for three, and still they fought on. They came on heroically, and then they came again. They kept coming, endlessly. They came until the corpses of the slain were piled high around the barricades, and hundreds of men were lying maimed and bloodied in the shadows of the night. To sustain their attack for as long as they did was an extraordinary feat of endurance and determination, and one which has received but scant tribute. Above all else, I hope, in writing this book, that we're able, in our national consciousness, to elevate the mighty Zulu above the role of mere extras in Sir Stanley Baker's movie, compelling entertainment as it undoubtedly was. For the Zulus of 1879 were real men. They had wives and they had children. They liked nothing better than to look proudly upon their cattle. They liked to gossip and they liked to laugh. And they were warriors too. Surely to be numbered amongst the most formidable warrior societies in the history of mankind. Let us recognise, then, not only the remarkable achievement of the British soldiers who held Rorke's Drift, but also the quite extraordinary courage of the men who gave their lives, in the words borne on the war monument at Ulundi, in defence of the old Zulu order. These days we can but reflect upon the passing of the old ways. But let us not forget that the children of the men of 1879 had children in their turn, and they in theirs, and three more generations since. And should you be moved by this remarkable tale to visit modern Zululand, the chances are you will be struck immediately by its beauty and by the warmth of its people. But go deeper and you'll learn something of its poverty, of the social ills consequent upon it, and of the devastating impact of pandemic disease. If you are a rich man or a wise man, please come home resolved to do whatever you can to help. Remarkably, for all their tribulations, the Zulus are smiling yet. Mike Snook. Prologue. From the bluff high above Sotondosa's Drift, Captain Alan Gardner looked down at the scenes of chaos and bloody carnage being played out beneath him. The river was full of bodies, live and dead, black and white, man and beast. The hillside opposite was swarming with the enemy. They were exultant, triumphant, victorious, and still they were mad for blood. Here and there a number of frenzied life-or-death chases through the rocks were in progress. Every so often, handfuls of frantic horsemen would come clattering down Pithy Hill at breakneck speed to enter the maelstrom around the drift, some of them separated and riding alone, others clustered in groups of three or four. Some men did indeed break their necks, or might as well have done, for a fall of any kind meant virtually instantaneous death at the hands of their merciless pursuers. Other men zigged and zagged desperately, trying hard to avoid the nimble-footed warriors scrambling over the rocks towards them. Many men, too shocked to think, some too stupefied even to care, trusted instinctively to Providence alone, and spurred their horses straight at the enemy, hoping somehow to break through at the gallop. Most of the terrified fugitives had long since emptied their revolvers. The pursuit had been relentless. There had been no question of pausing, and hence no time to reload, so that now horsemanship was their only defence. The lucky ones survived the frantic descent of Mpethe Hill and plunged over the riverbank with a terrific splash. There were treacherous subsurface boulders strewn in great quantities along both sides of the river, so that it was largely a matter of luck whether the riders kept their seats or not. Mounted or unhorsed, now they were just a target. Bullets threw up plumes of water around them. Throwing assegais came raining down about them. Number 3 column was no longer fighting. It was running, hell for leather, every man for himself, the devil take the hindmost. The scenes being played out around Sotondosa's Drift, soon to become better known as Fugitive's Drift, were more to do with bloody murder than with death in battle. Gardner's mind raced with vividly dramatic and unpleasant memories of the past 2.5 hours. He was glad to be alive. He was lucky to be alive. But he was shocked and he was frightened. Already his conscience was uneasy. Cavalryman and staff officer he may have been, but as a holder of the Queen's Commission, his proper place was with the embattled infantrymen of the 24th Regiment. He had last seen them falling back slowly in the face of an overpowering enemy assault, and, in common with many others, had lacked the inner strength to stand by them. Surely now, he reasoned, they were all dead. Henry Pullain, William Degacher, Charlie Pope, George Wardell, all of them dead and no doubt butchered. Gardner pulled himself together as best he could and tried to behave as an officer should behave in so grave a crisis. He tried to think of the wider military situation and what the enemy might do in the wake of so crushing a victory. Lord Chelmsford and his flying column were still at Mangeni, on the wrong side of the Zulu main impi. They were the largest force in the field and would have to shift for themselves. In the meantime, there were two outposts on the lines of communication to worry about. The garrisons of Rorke's Drift and Helpmacher were in the gravest danger, isolated, lightly held, and completely unfortified. The Rorke's Drift mission station was closest to the looming menace, just a few miles upstream, and there seemed to be nothing to prevent the Zulus descending upon it within the hour. Major Henry Spaulding, as far as Gardner knew, was in charge there. Under his command was a company of the 2nd, 24th, amounting to less than 100 redcoats, a numerically much stronger body of black levies, the handful of men who constitute No. 3 Column's logistics staff, and around 36 hospital patients. Helpmacher was about 12 miles away. Gardner knew that there was at least one company of the 1st, 24th there, and that by now it was distinctly possible that it had been joined by a second company of the same battalion. The great majority of Isandlwana survivors, Alan Gardner included, deemed discretion to be the better part of valour. To go to Rorke's Drift would be to put their heads in the noose once more, all but tantamount to an act of suicide. Mostly, they decided to head for distant Helpmacher and struck out across country. The lucky 5 regular officers were caught on the horns of a dilemma. They knew they could not go to Rorke's Drift without running the twin risks of being killed en route or of being ordered by Major Spaulding to stay there. When it came down to it, Spaulding would not actually need to say anything. It would be their bounden duty to stay. This was all well and good if the garrison had a sporting chance, but it seemed to have no chance at all. Gardner had made his decision. He was bound for Helpmacher with everybody else, but his sense of duty obliged him at least to alert the garrison at Rorke's Drift to its peril. He collared one of Durnford's mounted natives, almost certainly a member of the Edendale troop, and asked if he would ride via the mission station with a warning for the troops there. The man agreed to go, and Gardner quickly scribbled a pencil note to the post commander into his damp notebook. Moments later, this unknown but faithful trooper turned his exhausted pony away to the northwest, riding parallel to the line of the buffalo. Gardner spurred on to the southwest behind everybody else, bound for the Biggersburg high ground. Unaware that Gardner's man was already ahead of them, a number of other fugitives, some of whose identities are uncertain, would also cross the river and make the seemingly selfless decision to head for Rorke's Drift rather than Helpmacher. In fact, most were inspired by a combination of instinct and necessity, the ingrained need to find a route that they knew. It is perhaps indicative of their terrible ordeal up to this point, and the fear still coursing through their veins, that none of them stayed on at the mission to make a fresh stand. All would ride on after delivering a brief and doom-laden warning. In some cases, they cantered past without stopping, shouting a few words of pessimistic advice to the enlisted men. Thus, they evaded the time-consuming duty of making a full report to an officer and avoided any possibility of being ordered to stay. Away to the north, still on the Zulu bank of the river, Lieutenant Gert Adendorf of 2nd 3rd Natal Native Contingent, NNC, had fallen in with a trooper of the Natal Carbineers. Undoubtedly, they got away from Isandlwana on the wagon road some minutes before the Zulu right horn emerged from the hills to complete the horns of the buffalo encirclement of the camp. It follows that both of them had given up the fight well before it was lost beyond redemption. But in their own minds, at least, as they had looked down from the encampment at the great host manoeuvring impressively across the plain, there had been absolutely no doubt as to the outcome. Adendorf was a non-swimmer, and, with the buffalo in spate, was determined to avoid a risky river crossing if at all possible. Hence, he had settled on the ponts at Rorke's Drift as his immediate destination, a journey of around 7.5 miles. The two riders scanned the ground ahead for signs of the enemy, and from time to time looked back over their shoulders for any indication of a pursuit. They may have clapped eyes on harassed parties of Basuto or Amangwane riders some way behind them, and would certainly have overtaken scattered bands of NNC levies on the road, but reassuringly, for the time being at least, there were no Zulus in sight. They skirted the north bank of the Buffalo, crossed the Batshi stream, and rode on, until, at length, they came to the low ridge immediately above the ponds and began the long downhill gallop to the river. Lieutenant John Chard of the Royal Engineers was taking his responsibilities as the temporary post commander none too seriously. Major Spaulding would be back in a few hours, and in the meantime, Gonny Bromhead would have all the routine administration of the post well in hand. Chard had come up to Rorke's Drift only 3 days earlier, on Sunday the 19th of January. He'd arrived just in time to watch No. 3 Column depart for Isandlwana early on Monday morning. Later that same day, Colonel Durnford and his native troops had arrived at the river. They'd crossed the Buffalo in the late afternoon and established their bivouac on the site only recently vacated by Colonel Glynn's men. After 2 nights on the river, Durnford had also moved forward to Isandlwana at 8 a.m. that very morning. It was now Wednesday the 22nd of January 1879, a date destined to be immortalised by British historians and Zulu storytellers alike. Chard had passed Durnford on the old wagon road on his way back from an early morning excursion to Isandlwana, and had been used by the colonel to pass on instructions to the rearmost elements of his column. Now he was back at the river with nothing much to do for the rest of the day. Despite being Chard's junior in the army list, Lieutenant Gonville Bromhead had been at the post from the outset, was an experienced regimental officer with recent combat experience, was 2 years older than Chard, and was the commander of the only formed body of regular troops in the vicinity. In such circumstances, it would have been presumptuous of Chard to throw his weight around, and in any case, he was a quiet, modest man, and that was not at all his way. Instead, he was now sitting quietly beside his tent on the riverbank, half a mile from the mission buildings, writing a few lines home. It was not surprising that the events of the day had moved him to put pen to paper. He had never been in action before, but only that morning had had a sight of a substantial Zulu force as it manoeuvred on the high ground above the camp at Isandlwana. Nearby driver James Robson was pottering about the little campsite, unloading the last of his master's kit from their mule wagon following the largely nugatory trip up country. Somewhere close at hand was a young sergeant of the 2nd, 3rd Regiment, the Buffs, called Fred Milne, and a civilian called Mr. Daniels, who, between them, had charge of the crossing. The best asset at their disposal was a prefabricated pontoon, capable of taking a single ox wagon or a half company of troops. In August 1878, Colonel Durnford had surveyed all the border river crossings in preparation for the coming war and had recommended that 2 ponts be installed at Rorke's Drift. In the event, only 1 came up from Durban, and in lieu of the 2nd, Lieutenant Francis McDowell, Colonel Glynn's engineer advisor, had constructed a substantial cask ferry of standard RE design from timber and barrels. In addition to the pont and the ferry, both of which were hawser-operated, there was a whaler, capable of taking something around 15 rowers and passengers. Most contemporaneous orders and correspondence drew no distinction between the pont and the ferry and referred to the ponts in the plural, a convention which, for convenience's sake, will be followed from this point on. Standing guard over Milne, Daniels and their handful of black employees were a sergeant and half a dozen red-coated privates of B Company. It was probably one of the sentries who drew Chard's attention to the 2 horsemen racing down the ridge on the other side of the river. Chard put down his pen and looked up. The riders were moving fast, too fast. Nobody galloped at that sort of speed over the treacherous rocky terrain in this part of the country. It was hot, too hot. Nobody rode at such a lick in such extremes of temperature. The men were waving and shouting. Something was wrong. Something was badly wrong. Part 1. Race Against Time. Chapter 1. Nothing Will Happen. A quiet day in the offing. Rorke's Drift had been a bustling place for the past 3 weeks, but by the morning of the 22nd of January, the mood at the post had become distinctly downbeat. The campaign had moved on up country, and the men at the mission had been left behind. B Company of the 2nd, 24th, had been detailed to garrison duty at the drift in Lieutenant Colonel Henry de Gush's battalion orders as late as the evening before the invasion. There was profound disappointment at the news, even though it was expected to be only a temporary assignment pending the arrival of other troops. Thus it was, on Saturday the 11th of January, that No. 3 Column crossed the river frontier with Bromhead's company in the role of mere spectators. There had been some minor excitement the following morning, when the main body of the troops marched to attack Quasokhexe, the homestead of the most prominent local chieftain, Siheo, after which a few NNC casualties were brought back to the mission for treatment. After that, nothing much happened. For the ensuing 7 days, the column remained encamped just across the river, whilst an advanced party improved the old trader's wagon road ahead. The river was uncommonly high, swollen by the recent heavy summer rains into a powerful, surging torrent. The whites in Natal knew it as the Buffalo, but to their black workers and to the people of the proud nation-state on its far bank, it was the Mzinyathi. Each morning, the men of B Company paraded and drilled on their side of the river under Colour Sergeant Bourne and the Sergeant Section Commanders, for that was the army way, but otherwise there was next to nothing for them to do. Mealtimes served to break up the monotony. Occasionally, some heavily laden ox wagons would come plodding down from Help Makar with a consignment of foodstuffs or other military material. This would bring Assistant Commissaries Walter Dunn and James Dalton and the storekeeper, Mr. Louis Byrne, bustling from their tents to supervise the cross-loading of the cargo to the one-time chapel, now a storehouse. Then the wagons would go plodding back again. From time to time, one of the staff officers at the post would gallop off on some unknown errand. Then, 2 days ago, the main column had moved off to establish a new camp at the foot of Isandlwana, to be replaced later in the day by Colonel Durnford's native troops, ordered up from Vermark's farm on the Help Makar Road. The two thatched mission buildings were nestled beneath the steep western slopes of a commanding hill known in Zulu as Shihane, or the Eyebrow. The resident Swedish missionary, Mr. Otto Witt, had attempted arbitrarily to rename the feature the Oscarberg in honour of his king, but nobody was much interested in a foreigner's views on the subject, and mostly insisted on referring to it by its old African name. Witt's missionary society had acquired the property a little over 3 years earlier. It was purchased from the Surtees family, who had lived there for only a short while following the death of the first and most notable resident of the plot, who some said had died by his own hand. It's thought that Jim Rorke was the son of an Irish soldier, and that he had himself seen service in the 1846 War of the Axe, the 7th of the Cape Frontier Wars with the Corsair. Unlike his father, young Jim had never been a regular soldier, and with the cessation of hostilities was free to go wherever the mood took him. The new frontier was to be found in Natal, and so it was that he headed north in search of opportunity and adventure. Soon he was looking over a remote 1,000-acre plot on the west bank of the Buffalo River. It was a pretty enough spot, and he stayed. He lived by the usual frontier combination of hunting, trading, and farming. When he built his house in 1849, the district was rich with big game, but it was not long before it had been shot out, a process in which Jim Rorke himself played a significant part. In due course, he took a wife, had a son, and enlisted in a local part-time volunteer unit called the Buffalo Border Guard. On a good day, the BBG might muster 30 men. Eventually, Rorke rose to be its lieutenant, largely because by the 1870s he'd been in the area much longer than most, rather than for any innate military talent he had. The best river crossing for miles was on Rorke's spread, and with traders plying back and forth into Zululand, he and his wife seldom went too long without receiving visitors. The Zulu came to refer to Rorke's place as Kwajim. The traders were quick to fuel an apparently insatiable cross-border demand for firearms, compelling the colonial authorities in Pietermaritzburg to embargo the trade. In due course, it was driven underground, but a good many weapons continued to find their way into Zululand via Rorke's drift. Whether Rorke himself played a role in gun running is not known, though as a member of what was, in effect, a part-time constabulary, this would seem improbable. By the middle of 1875, Rorke was engaged in negotiations to sell up, but in October that year, he died. He was buried at the foot of Shiani, where his grave may still be seen to this day. Not long after her husband's death, Mrs. Rorke vacated the property to make way for Mr. and Mrs. Robert Surtees and their daughter and son-in-law. 3 years on, with the property having in the interim changed hands for a second time, Otto Witt had taken the requisitioning of his mission buildings by the military with reasonably good grace, encouraged in his cooperation by the prospect of receiving a substantial rent in recompense. At first, he tried to exact an unreasonable price for the lease of a few rooms, but was soon put straight by irritated staff officers. When it was made plain to him that his entire property would be required, at a rent to be decided by the government, he sent his family away to stay near the magistracy at Msinga, and acquired himself a tent from which to keep a watchful eye on things. Occasionally, he made himself useful as an interpreter. Inevitably, he befriended the Reverend George Smith, the vicar of Estcourt, who had come up to the mission to serve as a temporary chaplain to the forces. Smith was born in Norfolk in 1845, went to a college in Canterbury, and later emigrated to South Africa to become a lay missionary. He had been ordained by the Bishop of Natal in 1872. The previous Sunday, Smith had conducted a drumhead service on the other side of the river at the request of Colonel Richard Glynn in advance of the departure of the troops for Isandlwana the following morning. Since then, Smith had devoted himself to one of the traditional roles of an army padre, that of fussing around the sick. Witt's house had been turned into a base hospital facility, a temporary home to between 30 and 40 recuperating soldiers. The precise number of patients cannot now be definitively established, but Surgeon Reynolds, who ought to have known, thought that there were 35. The highest possibility is 39, but any number in between is just as likely. Sergeant Robert Maxfield, a 21-year-old section commander in G Company, 2nd 24th, from Newport, Monmouthshire, was suffering from a raging typhoid fever and was in the most serious condition by far. Not unnaturally, this had earned him preferential treatment from the doctor, who had bedded him down in the comfort of Mr. and Mrs. Witt's requisitioned bed. Everybody else was sleeping on mattresses resting on pallets, raised only a few inches off the floor. A few of the patients, such as Lieutenant Thomas Purvis and Corporal Jesse Mayer of 1st 3rd NNC, had been wounded a week earlier in the action at Siheo's Kraal. The only black patient was one of Commandant Maori Brown's Isikoza levies, wounded in the same action. Others had been injured in one of the unfortunate accidents which invariably take a toll of a large military force deployed in the field. The majority were in various stages of typhoid fever, brought on by rough living in the field, though nobody else was in nearly so bad a state as young Maxfield. 35-year-old James Henry Reynolds was an Irish-born army surgeon. He was raised at Dalliston House, Greenough, County Longford, and went on to study medicine at Trinity College, Dublin, graduating in 1867. His first tour as a medical officer had been with the 36th Regiment in India, where he was commended by the Commander-in-Chief for his devotion to duty during a cholera epidemic. He was now the regimental medical officer at the 1st 24th, to which he had been attached for the past 4 years. He had participated in the Diamond Fields Expedition of 1875 and in the 9th Cape Frontier War. Ordinarily, he would have been with his battalion at Isandlwana. Instead, Sergeant Major Peter Shepherd, the principal medical officer, was taking care of all the units up with the column and had detached Reynolds to run the base hospital. The doctor was accompanied everywhere he went by a little terrier, which, so the story goes, belonged to Lieutenant Fred Godwin Austin, until recently an officer in Bromhead's B Company, but now up country with Charlie Pope's G Company. To assist him in his work, Reynolds had two misemployed privates of the 24th, plus Corporal Miller, 2nd Corporal McMahon, and Private Luddington of the Army Hospital Corps. The 28-year-old Private Harry Hook, a decent and clean-living teetotaler from Monmouth, a man whose memory was badly failed by his cinema portrayal, had been excused his routine duties with B Company in order to act as the hospital cook. Similarly, Private John Waters of the 1st, 24th, had been detached from his battalion to act as an additional hospital orderly. The dirt road down to the drift ran north of the mission station for half a mile, with the Shiani high ground on its right-hand side, but on the opposite side of the river it swung eastwards in the direction of Isandlwana. This meant that it was quite impossible to see anything of the Sphinx-like hill from the immediate area of the mission. In order to gain such a view, it was necessary either to walk down to the riverbank and look hard right, where Isandlwana was visible in a gap in the hills, or to climb to the summit of Shiani, from where a much better view was to be had, incorporating the rear or western slopes of Isandlwana, the saddle immediately to its south, much of the Manzimyana Valley, and a good deal of the high ground to the north of Colonel Glynn's new camp. Even from here it was not possible to see anything of the camp itself, which was located on the far side of the Sphinx, or anything very much of the great eastern plain beyond. Shiani also blocked any view of the river gorge to the southeast, and hence of the old native crossing downstream, known after a local chief as Sotondosis Drift. While there was no view downstream, the mission commanded a good view out across the Buffalo River Valley in the upstream direction to the west, and in the direction of Helpmacar and the Biggersburg High Ground. 1,000 yards to the southwest was Kwasing Kindi Hill, like Shiani, a dominating piece of high ground which restricted the wider view, but too far away from the mission to be of any real tactical significance. Two junior officers of the transport staff, Lieutenant Horace Smith Dorian of the 95th and Sub-Lieutenant Thomas Griffith of the 24th, had departed for Isandlwana the previous afternoon. They'd been due to bring a convoy of wagons down from the camp to replenish their loads from the commissariat store first thing that morning, but Smith Dorian had reappeared without them. He rode in to take breakfast with the rest of the officers not too long after 7 a.m. As he ate, he passed on all the news of the day, that the convoy had been indefinitely postponed, and that he had met John Chard on the road on his way down from the camp, that he had just delivered a message for Colonel Durnford's troops to move up to Isandlwana, and that most of the 2nd, 24th and the artillery had moved out with Lord Chelmsford at 4 a.m. to support the colonial and native troops on the far side of the great expanse of plain east of Isandlwana. There appeared to be, Smith Dorian continued, a strong likelihood of a fight. When Major Spaulding was out of earshot, he confided to Gonny Bromhead that he intended going back up country to see if he could get involved in all the excitement. He was short of cartridges for his pistol and asked Bromhead if he could spare any. Bromhead gave him all he could, 11 rounds in all, and not long afterwards Smith Dorian was back in the saddle, bound once again for Isandlwana. Brevet Major Henry Spaulding of the 104th Regiment of Foot was Deputy Assistant Adjutant General, DAAG, of No. 3 Column, an appointment which today would be labelled Deputy Chief of Staff, DCOS. As such, he was responsible to Colonel Richard Glynn, the column commander, for personnel and logistic matters. His principal task was to keep the supplies necessary to sustain No. 3 Column moving forward from the main logistic depot at Helpmacar via the storehouse at Rorke's Drift to the backs of Glynn's wagons. As well as his role as No. 3 Column's chief logistician, Spaulding also had a command function on the lines of communication. The garrisons of Rorke's Drift and Helpmacar were both in his charge. In addition to Bromhead's B Company, there was also a large body of unassigned NNC levies at Rorke's Drift. Although they're commonly referred to as Stevenson's Company, this is not a strictly accurate designation. They were, in fact, the surplus of men above and beyond the 2,200 required to constitute the two battalions of Commandant Rupert Lonsdale's 3rd Regiment NNC. Lonsdale had left a Captain William Stevenson in charge of them. Little is known of Stevenson's background, but he seems to have been from the Cape rather than Natal, and may possibly have been one of a number of volunteers who, having commanded Fingo levies in the 9th Cape Frontier War, then came up from King Williamstown to officer the newly raised NNC. Stevenson had only 3 European corporals to assist him. There's no agreement in the sources as to the overall strength of his command, but it was certainly recognised as being far larger than the 100-man norm for a company. The highest estimate offered by the men who fought at Rorke's Drift is 400, but a distinctly authoritative figure is to be found in Lord Chelmsford's correspondence. Lonsdale's regiment has been reinforced and is now about 500 over its strength, Natives are still coming in by twos and threes. I am leaving, however, those in excess of 2,200 at Rorke's Drift. They will be useful for defence and also for working parties on the roads. Like all the native infantry contingents, Stephen's levies were dressed only in a loincloth and were armed with their traditional African weapons, cowhide shields, assegais and knobkerries. If they were armed in accordance with the general policy for the NNC, one man in 10 would have been issued with a rifle and 5 rounds of ammunition. It is more likely, however, as they were surplus to establishment, that no such allowance was made for them. As late arrivals, they would have been all but untrained in any formal military sense. Unsure quite what to do with them, Major Spaulding left them encamped on the long slope above the river, out of sight and out of mind. As long as he fed them well, he reasoned, they would be content enough. B Company of the 2nd 24th was 94 strong. Its original company commander, the elder of 2 Godwin Austin brothers in the battalion, had been accidentally wounded by one of his own men during the recent frontier war against the Corsa. The Martini Henry had no safety catch, and in the dense bush country of the Amatola Mountains, where a man had to be ready to fire at a split second's notice, the odd negligent discharge was to some extent inevitable. Alfred Godwin Austin had been unlucky, but his misfortune was to have a silver lining for Bromhead, who was elevated to command B Company in his stead. Bromhead was 5 feet 10 inches tall and powerfully built. Now 33 years of age, he had been born at Versailles on the 29th of August 1845, though the family home was at Thirlby Hall in Lincolnshire. His father was Major Edmund de Gonville Bromhead, who had fought at Waterloo as a subaltern. As Gonny was his father's 3rd son, the family baronetcy was destined never to pass to him. He was educated at the Magnus Grammar School in Newark. In the dying years of purchase, his father acquired him an ensign's vacancy in the 24th. He was appointed on the 20th of April 1867 and was promoted to lieutenant 4 years later. During his early years in the regiment, which included time in India, Bromhead boxed and wrestled with some distinction. He now had over 11 years of military service behind him. Supposedly, he had already suffered significant hearing loss, but most seasoned infantrymen were deaf to a greater or lesser extent, and there are no really convincing references to a serious disability in the pre-January 1879 sources. It would seem distinctly possible that his much more pronounced and noticeable deafness actually originated with the cacophony of small arms fire at Rorke's Drift. Bromhead was popular with his brother officers at a social level, but for some unknown reason, his commanding officer seems to have had a low opinion of his merits as a soldier. Whatever the origin of Henry de Gash's doubts, and he may simply have been a poor judge of character, events were to prove his curious lack of confidence in Bromhead to be entirely unwarranted. Perhaps he would never set the world on fire, but he knew his business as an infantry officer and was a decent, warm-hearted man, traits which earned him the affection and loyalty of his men. Bromhead had no other subaltern officer under him, and so the next senior man in the company was its colour sergeant, the 24-year-old Frank Bourne. He had been born 1 of 8 sons, and with next to no prospect of a worthwhile inheritance on the land, had run away from his father's farm to enlist the very moment he came of age. He stood only 5 feet 6 inches tall, and was so uncommonly young for a man of his rank that the senior men in the company referred to him, behind his back, as the kid. The 4 section commanders were Sergeants Joseph Windridge, Henry Gallagher, and George Smith, and Lance Sergeant Thomas Williams. There were also 4 corporals, 2 lance corporals, 2 drummers, and 80 privates. Now that the 24th had acquired a new regional identity under Cardwell's Localisation Act, something around 40% of the 2nd Battalion was made up of young Welshmen from the rural market towns of Mid Wales and Monmouthshire, or from the increasingly industrialised eastern valleys. By temperament, they were a stolid, determined and unflappable breed of men, all good qualities in a crisis. Most corners of England were also represented within the ranks of B Company, and, as with any element of Queen Victoria's army, there was the inevitable smattering of saints and scholars from across the Irish Sea. Haltmacar, a tiny hamlet of 2 dwelling houses and a couple of corrugated sheds erected by the commissaries, was located high above the Buffalo River Valley on the Biggersburg Plateau, some 12 miles southwest of Rorke's Drift. Captain Thomas Rainforth and G Company of the 1st 24th were temporarily encamped there, pending a move up to Rorke's Drift, where they were to construct and man a protective redoubt on the ridge above the ponts. Brevet Major Russell Upchur had marched in to help Macar with his D Company, 1st 24th, as recently as 6 p.m. on Tuesday evening, following the usual protracted and exacting march up the lines of communication from Pietermaritzburg and before that Durban. Whilst Major Spaulding had expected Rainforth to come up to the drift on Monday, Rainforth himself appears to have been under the impression that he should wait for Upchur to relieve him at Help Macar first. They were a well-proven pairing. Less than a year earlier, they'd trounced a Corsa army at the Battle of Centani. Inevitably, the poor condition of the Grey Town Road and the flooded watercourses astride it had imposed significant delays on Upchur, not least when one of his transport wagons turned over in the Mooi River. In the event, orders were given first thing on Wednesday morning that both companies should depart for the front after lunch. Rainforth would halt at the river to build the redoubt and protect the crossing, whilst Upchur would overnight at Rorke's Drift and then continue on to Isandlwana to marry up with the main body of the 1st Battalion. Spaulding was as yet unaware, however, that their combined move was now imminent. It was intended that, in due course, all the 24th Regiment companies employed on the lines of communication would be relieved in place by the five companies of the 2nd, 4th, the King's Own Royal Regiment, under the command of Colonel E. W. Bray, which were even now marching up from Durban and Pietermaritzburg. When Bray's men were up, and he had established his battalion headquarters at Rorke's Drift, the three 24th Regiment companies still in Natal would move on up country to rejoin their respective battalions in the field. Colonel Bray himself was some way in advance of his main body, travelling north along the border road with a convoy of 28 wagons. There were only 22 men of his regiment in the escort, notwithstanding the fact that 15 of the wagons were loaded with significant quantities of small arms ammunition. By Wednesday morning, the convoy was nearing the Umsinga magistracy. As the resident magistrate, Mr. Henry Finn, had gone up to Isandlwana to join Lord Chelmsford's staff as his political adviser, his friend, Mr. William Beaumont, ordinarily the magistrate at the frontier town of Newcastle, had come down to cover Finn's duties and take care of his wife, children and sister-in-law. Beaumont also had charge of a number of small detachments of native levies deployed at various lookouts and outposts along the Buffalo River stretch of the frontier between Natal and Zululand. Colonel Bray might reasonably expect his convoy to get to Help Macar early on Thursday, though he personally could always ride on ahead of the wagons, in which case he would be able to complete the journey that day. By the end of the week at the latest, Spaulding's command function on the lines of communication would be passed across to Bray, leaving the DAAG free to concentrate on sustaining No. 3 column logistically. Also moving on the border road that morning, having set off from Sandsprout at dawn, with the 1,000 black levies and 100 white officers and NCOs of 2nd 1st NNC, under the command of Major Harcourt Bengoff, a regular officer of the 77th Regiment. Bengoff had originally been assigned to Durnford's No. 2 column, charged with defence of the border against counter-invasion. Now he was acting quasi-independently of his colonel, under the personal direction of Lord Chelmsford himself. His current orders were to cross the Buffalo at Elands Kraal and march on into the Mangeni area. Only that morning his lordship had changed his mind yet again, a character trait to which he was notoriously prone. He now wanted Bengoff up at Rorke's Drift instead. The order had been issued too late, however, to prevent 2nd, 1st NNC marching for Elands Kraal as originally planned. The battalion would arrive at Umsinga mid-morning and was then guided down the valley to the Elands Kraal crossing by Mr. Beaumont. By early afternoon, Bengoff and his men were in Zululand. Fortunately, they were well hidden in difficult hill country and were quite oblivious to the high drama being played out only a few miles away. Spaulding hands over command. After passing Durnford's orders down the line of his already overextended column, John Chard rode on towards the Batchy Valley. A little way down the road he met his mule wagon, his five sappers, and the two native employees he'd taken on in Durban, coming the other way. Chard was worried that the large body of Zulus he'd seen on the high ground above Isandlwana could now be somewhere between the camp and the river, and that they might constitute a threat to the ponds. Some 1,500 warriors had swept across the top of the Tehelani Spur at around 9:30 a.m. and had subsequently been reported by the pickets as having moved away to the northwest, that is to say, towards the western end of the Engedla Heights, from where it would be a simple matter for them to cut or threaten the road to Rorke's Drift. Chard must have realised that he had undertaken his trip to Isandlwana in altogether too lackadaisical a fashion. As his inquiries at the column headquarters had revealed that he was not personally required at Isandlwana, he now instructed his driver to turn the wagon in the road. Chard, his batman, Robson, his driver and his forelorper, a cape-coloured man and a black teenager respectively, would be making the return journey to Rorke's Drift. Corporal Gamble and Sappers McLaren, Wheatley and Cuthbert were needed at the camp, however, and were instructed to jump down from the wagon, hurry along behind Colonel Durnford's column, and report as soon as they were able to Lieutenant McDowell, R.E., who for the moment was up country with Lord Chelmsford and Colonel Glynn. It was now something around 10 a.m. Chard and his three remaining companions cannot have reached the river much before 11:30, and a nerve-wracking journey it must have been. Once he had been ferried across the river, Chard was shown a written order sent down from the mission station by Major Spaulding. It stipulated that, since Durnford's command had now moved on, Bromhead was to find a 7-man guard for the pont, and that Stevenson should supplement it with a party of 50 levies. The duty could be discontinued once Rainforth's company had established itself on the ridge above the drift. The B Company detail under Lance Sergeant Williams was already down at the river. The NNC Company, however, was suffering from one of the periodic breakdowns in military efficiency that bedevil bodies of irregular troops, much to the annoyance of their regular army counterparts. Whilst a first 50-man detail had turned up earlier in the day, their NCO had marched them away at the end of their shift without having been relieved, and no second watch had yet put in an appearance. Spaulding's order went on to direct that the ponts be secured each night on the Natal bank of the river. Chard instructed his party to unload the mule wagon and re-erect their two tents on the riverbank. Then he spurred on to the mission in search of Spaulding, so that he could brief him on the latest developments at Isandlwana. He found him at his tent and proceeded to describe how the troops left at the camp had been under arms since breakfast time. He went on to report that he had himself...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.